4:05, a friend I have called Jesus, whose love is strong and true. Let's all stand together as we sing. 4:05. All stand and sing our message together.
A friend I have called Jesus, whose love is strong and true, and ever fails, however it's done, no matter what I do.
Sometimes the clouds of trouble be dim, the sky above, but it's just like Jesus to roll those clouds away. Let's sing that second together.
Sometimes the clouds of trouble be dim, the sky above. I cannot see my Savior's face. I doubt his wondrous love, but he from heaven's mercy sees, beholding my despair, in pity bursts the clouds between and shows me he's there. It's just like Jesus to roll the clouds away. It's just like Jesus to keep me day by day. It's just like Jesus all along the way. It's just like his grace.
Singing tonight. Boy, it's good to be in church on Sunday night, isn't it? And thanks for being back in your place, and had a good morning this morning, and looking forward to what God has in store for us tonight. Thanks for being in church. Let's open with prayer, shall we? Father, we bow before you tonight, and we thank you, Lord, for your great love that you have toward us. And Lord, we understand and we know that we only love you because you first loved us. And we're thankful so much for your unconditional love that you have for each of us tonight. And Lord, we bow before you here at the beginning of our service, and we ask you to meet with us. We are a needy people, and we need our God to meet with us tonight. And so, Lord, use the music, use the fellowship of God's people, the giving of our tithe and offering to you, and Lord, bless and honor the preaching of your word. And Lord, accomplish your will in each one of our lives tonight. And I pray we can leave in a little bit saying it sure was good to have been in the house of the Lord today. Father, control the service. Make it pleasing in your sight. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
Let's go to number 341. How many have victory in Jesus tonight? 341. Let's sing about it. I heard an old, old story how a Savior came from glory. On that verse together.
I heard an old, old story how a Savior came from glory. My Savior.
singing, and the Praise God came years ago. I don't think that's in the hymn book, is it? And that came years ago. The Sold came with the RU ministry. And as we sing that on Friday nights for Reformers Unanimous, when you sing he bought me, sold. And we do that every Friday night, and so that just kind of bleeds over into the church service. Amen. And good singing tonight. That's great. Well, listen, a few announcements for us now. Regular schedule this week. Wednesday night, Bible study right here, 7 o'clock, continuing our studies on separation on Wednesday evening, and the children's clubs will be meeting Wednesday night as well, and so be in your place Wednesday night, and then, of course, Thursday night with the RU down at the prison in Central Reception Center. Had 36 there Thursday night and had 13 men receive Christ as their Savior. It was a great night down there. I think they had 15 at London yesterday with five new guys in the program. So good things are happening in the RU in the prison. Remember, though, tomorrow night, what time? 5 to 8 p.m. at Chick-fil-A on Stringtown Road is the fundraiser for the teenage missions trip. Going with our church down to Mexico, June 10 through 18. And so get there and let everybody know about it that you can, and have them come between those hours and mention the Teenagers Bible Baptist Missions, mention something like that, and we'll be there, and there'll be signs and such, so you'll hopefully be reminded of that, and let's make it a great night for the teenagers tomorrow night. And then, ladies, things, I think there are over 100 now that have signed up for the mother-daughter luncheon on the 14th. That's just, I think, only within 4 or 5 of the limit. So if you're going to go, get your reservation in, and I don't want you to miss out on that. Mrs. Burks will be a great blessing to you. 11:30, May 14th. See the Mrs. Barham will be downstairs, I think. Is she in nursery? Okay. Someone will relieve her at the end of the service and help her get there. Someone will be there with the tickets and the reservation, and you can get signed up for that. But you will be blessed that day, all right? And we're excited about that. Okay. We'll take just a moment. We'll welcome any guests we have with us tonight. Anybody here tonight for the very first time? I met Lori Manning right here. Lori's from the north side of Columbus. She's a radio listener and came to the service tonight. And I appreciate you so much being here, Lori. The usher's going to get here eventually with a visitor's card. And caught him by surprise. And thank you. If you'll take just a moment and fill that out for us, we'd appreciate that. We'll just have a record of your visit with us tonight. And a little bit, we have the offering. You just drop that card in the plate, if you would. Keep the pen as our gift to you for coming tonight. We're glad you're here. Let's give her a warm welcome, shall we?
249, 249. Oh, what a wonderful, wonderful day. Day I will never forget. 249, heaven came down and glory filled my soul. Let's sing that first together. Oh, what a wonderful, wonderful day. Day I will never forget. After I'd wandered in darkness away, Jesus, my Savior, I met. Oh, what a tender, compassionate friend. He met the need of my heart. Shattered, dispelling with joy, I am telling, he made all the darkness depart. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole. My sins were washed away and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. On that last, now I've a hope that will surely endure after the passing of time. I have a future in heaven for sure, there in the mansion sublime. And it's because of that wonderful day when at the cross I believe. Riches eternal and blessings supernal from his precious hand I receive. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole. My sins were washed away and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. Sing it now. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. Amen. That's great. 492. Would you turn with me? 492. Jesus Christ has made to me all I need, all I need. Would you stand with me as you find 492 together? Let's sing that first. Jesus Christ is all I need, all I need. He alone is all my plea. He is all I need. Wisdom, righteousness, and power, holiness, this very hour. My redemption full and free, he is all I need. He redeemed me when he died. All I need, all I need. I with him was crucified. He is all I need. Wisdom, righteousness, and power, holiness is very hour. My redemption full and free, he is all I need. Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing the last stanzas together. Thank you. He's the treasure of my soul. All I need, all I need. He hath cleansed and made me whole. He is all I need. Wisdom, righteousness, and power. Holiness is very are. My redemption full and free. He is all I need. Jesus is my all in all. All I need, all I need. Let's sing that fourth together. Jesus is my all in all. All I need, all I need. While he keeps, I cannot fall. He is all I need. Wisdom, righteousness, and power. Holiness, this very hour. My redemption, full and free. He is all I need. Let's sing that last together when we get to the chorus. Of the instruments drop out. On that last, glory, glory to the Lamb. By his Spirit sealed I am. He is all I need. Wisdom, righteousness, and power. Holiness, this very hour, my redemption full and free, he is all I need.
Everybody said? Amen. Amen. Be seated if you will. Great singing tonight. Ushers are coming. We'll get our offering now this evening. Give us God has blessed and prospered you through another week. Appreciate your faithful giving. And be in prayer for the country fair coming up. It'll be here before we know it. May 21 will be upon us. And a lot between happening between now and then. But keep praying daily for that, if you would. God will bless the efforts of that, and it'll be a wonderful, wonderful time. Okay? Well, let's pray. We'll ask God's blessing on our offering tonight. Brother Danny Wright, lead us in prayer, please.
Let's pray. Father, you truly are all we need, and we're so grateful to be a part of the family of God. Lord, I just pray that we can continue growing in our knowledge and understanding of who you are, that everybody in this room would build a personal, intimate, real, life-transforming relationship with you, Father. I pray, Father, that the teens have a good turnout tomorrow at Chick-fil-A. We pray for the country fair that's coming up, Father. I pray that many decisions will be made for thee. We love you, Lord, and we can't get through this thing called life without you. We need you, Father. Without you, we're nothing. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen.
Take your Bible this evening, if you would, to the book of Acts, chapter 17. Acts, chapter 17, please, for our scripture reading. We're going to read with verse number 16 this evening, and we'll read through verse number 23, Acts 17. And beginning with verse 16, reading through verse 23, reading responsively as we normally do. And as our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture. All of us standing, please, to read God's word. And let's begin on verse 16 of Acts chapter 17. Ready? Now, while Paul waited for them at Athens, his spirit was stirred in him when he saw the city wholly given to idolatry. Therefore disputed he in the synagogue with the Jews and with the devout persons, and in the market daily with them that met with him. Then certain philosophers of the Epicureans and of the Stoics encountered him, and some said, "What will this babbler say?" Others some, "He seemeth to be a setter forth of strange gods, because he preached unto them Jesus and the resurrection." And they took him and brought him unto Areopagus, saying, "May we know what this new doctrine whereof thou speakest is? For thou bringest certain strange things to our ears. We would know, therefore, what these things mean." For all the Athenians and strangers which were there spent their time in nothing else, but either to tell or to hear some new thing. Then Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said, "Ye men of Athens, I perceive that in all things ye are too superstitious." And let's finish with verse 23 together also. "For as I passed by and beheld your devotions, I found an altar with this inscription, 'To the unknown God.' Whom therefore ye ignorantly worship, him declare I unto you." And let's pray. Father, add your blessing, please, to the reading of our scripture here this evening. Lord, I thank you for the wonderful music tonight and the blessing and encouragement it's been to us. And Lord, we ask that you would continue to prepare our hearts and make us ready to receive the truth from your word this evening. And we pray your blessing upon the special now to that end. Minister to us and put our heart in tune with your heart, that we may hear what the Spirit would say to his church this evening. It's in Christ's name we ask it. Amen.
Jesus, I am resting in the joy of what thou art. I am finding out the greatness of thy loving heart. Thou hast bid me gaze upon thee, and thy beauty fills my soul. For by thy transforming power, thou hast made me whole. Oh, how great thy loving kindness, vaster, broader than the sea. Oh, how marvelous thy goodness, lavished all on me. Yes, I rest in thee, beloved. Know what wealth of grace is thine. Know thy certainty of promise, and have made it mine. Simply trusting thee, Lord Jesus, I behold thee as satisfies my heart, satisfies its deepest longings, meets, supplies its every need, compasseth me round with blessing, thine is love indeed. Ever lift thy face upon me, as thy work can wait for thee. Beneath thy smile, Lord Jesus, earth's dark shadows flee. Brightness of my Father's glory, sunshine of my Father's face, keep me ever trusting, resting, fill me grace. Keep me ever trusting, resting. Fill me with thy grace.
Amen. Thank you. Father in heaven, we bow before you in prayer as we now come to the preaching of your word. I pray, God, that you would open our understanding tonight. Lord, I need your help as I bring this message this evening and things that I need to say, help me to say them. Things that I maybe have not planned to say, but I should bring them into my mind, bring them into my heart, and I'll say them. Lord, if there's something here that I should not say this evening, then hold me back from saying it. Lord, I pray that just exactly what you want for your people tonight to hear and to understand, that we would understand how we ought to live in the world in which we're in right now, and the things that go on around us and how we should respond. Help us to glean some truth this evening from your word that'll help us to be the people that you desire us to be. So help us tonight, and help each of us to give us ears to hear what you would say to your church this evening. It's in Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Acts 17, if your Bible's back open to there. Paul here has come to Athens, Greece. And I think he, by the way, this is a very worldly place, so to speak, and not one that knew anything really about God. In fact, they had gods and statues to every kind of god you could think of. It would line the streets. You couldn't look anywhere without seeing an idol. And as Paul was in that city waiting for Timothy and Silas, it says his heart was stirred within him as he saw the city wholly given to idolatry. And as he walked around and saw a city that had nothing to do with the true God. In fact, the only thing close was they had an idol that says just said to the unknown God, just in case they missed somebody. They wanted to make sure they covered all the bases. And Paul took that opportunity to, he's going to take opportunity here to have a discussion with them, to eventually preach the gospel to them. What I want you to notice, what he did not do when he went into Athens was get himself a hotel room and hole up in there and not go see anybody. Okay, he didn't isolate himself. He took the situation on, and he took it on head on. He realized nothing in there, by the way, he realized nothing in Athens had an attraction for him. There was nothing in the world that they could offer that could compare to what he had in Christ. And in the darkest of situations, I want you to notice that what I want to bring out to you is Paul didn't build a wall around himself. Paul built a bridge with which to speak to people. We live in a day when it's real popular to build walls. Okay? We have somebody running for president that's running for president. In fact, let's build a bigger wall. Right? And we have the answer in Israel is to build a wall. and they've built part of a wall around Israel to try to protect them. And we have neighborhoods where anymore they build neighborhood, and what do you do with your backyard? You put up a fence and put up a wall so you don't ever see your neighbor and know who your neighbor is. And how many, when you grew up, how many in the room, when you grew up, you didn't have any fence in your backyard? Most of us were that way. You just, you went from one place to another, and you knew who your neighbors were. And we're not in that world anymore. We're not in that nation anymore. I'm going to spare some of the details of Paul's past and such, but when he got to Athens, he he preaches in two places, the synagogue and in the marketplace. And you see that in verse number 17, that he disputed he in the synagogue with the Jews and with the devout persons, and then in the market daily with them that met with him. So he's speaking to people. He's talking to people. He's opening up conversation with them. And he observed the city is completely given to idolatry. They say there were more idols in Athens, Greece, than in the rest of the country combined. Okay? A city given to idolatry. And here, there was they would have a marketplace or a public square where they would come and discuss these things. In fact, verse 21 is a parenthesis. What's a parenthesis in the Bible? It's a private note from the author to the reader. So this is a parenthesis from God to us to tell us something about the people in Athens. You know what he said? They spent their time in nothing else but either to tell or to hear some new thing. Okay? And so Paul took advantage of that. And there were Epicureans there and Stoics there. And the Epicureans, let me tell you just briefly about them. They were the gods they believed in felt like they weren't really interested in the affairs of life. They didn't care what you did. You just, the idea was live and get as much pleasure out of life as you can, because that's what it really was all about. Pleasure was the chief good. And so do, if it felt good, do it. You only go through life once, grab it with all the gusto you can. No, we don't have anything like that today, do we? Those were the Epicureans. Just indulge yourself all you can because you only go around once. I think the Epicureans are still alive and well in America, don't you? The Stoics were more fatalists. They were kind of, they insisted on some self-righteousness. Their goal was to talk and debate about natural law and the things of life. And they considered Paul a babbler. That he had some scraps of learning from here and there, but they weren't sure what he was even talking about. Now, what you have to understand is, if you came and you wanted to talk about a god that wasn't one of their gods, you could be arrested and charged with a crime. Okay? And so it was very tedious ground that Paul's treading on here, that he has to relate. That's why when he begins to speak to them, he talks about the unknown god. Here's the one I'm talking to you about. So he knows that I'm talking about one of yours that you have a monument to. Okay? And I'm going to present my view to you, and that Areopagus that's mentioned here is the same thing as Mars Hill, mentioned down in verse 22, a place where they all assembled and they all met, particularly a court would meet, with had 30 city officials there, and Paul is permitted to speak. It was about 50 feet high that rose above everybody, and so it was easy for everyone to hear what was going on, and people would gather and listen to these speakers and listen to their conversation. And here, Paul begins to present the gospel. And he says in verse 22, that I perceive that in all things you are too superstitious. He said, for as I passed by and beheld your devotions, I found an altar with this inscription, to the unknown God. Whom therefore ye ignorantly worship, him declare I unto you. Now, he starts out by, you're too superstitious. Now, superstition really has reference to a god. It has reference to religion. It has anything, a god, a religion, or anything that you that you take, I'm trying to read this here, as being superior to man, are the belief of what is absurd, or belief without evidence. That's superstition. Something you believe, but there's no evidence to back it up. Okay? That's what he's saying that these folks are. And his remark to them was not a complaint, it was a compliment. That's how they took it. And he confirms it by this altar to the unknown God. And so besides all the altars and the statues and the deities that they had names for, this God was the unknown God. And he's telling, this is the God I want to talk to you about. And he's going to expound to them who God is. Now let me say this, preacher, why are you talking about all this? Because I believe our country now is more like Athens. We have become a godless country. We have become a country of idols. We have become a country that does not have a basis and a moral foundation in God or the Word of God. And so where Paul started with these folks is where we're going to have to learn to start with people in order to talk to them about who God is. The God that we're referring to when we begin to talk to them is not the God that they're thinking of in their mind. They have a whole different idea of who God is. And so we have to begin to understand how we give a loving response to them, a loving message to them, even though it's a hateful world. And we live in a hateful world. We live in a world that, and we'll say more about that in just a few minutes. But I want you to notice what Paul did as he gives the gospel to them and begins to tell them about God. Notice in verse 24 as he begins to tell them who God was. You know where he starts? God that made the world and all things therein, seeing that he is the Lord of heaven and earth, dwelleth not in temples made with hands. Where did Paul start? He started in creation, didn't he? He started at the beginning. He's the creator. He's the one who made everything. Why do you think now for a generation, our nation has continued to push the evolution agenda, that there is no God, see, and that we're just here, and that by the way, that snowballs into a variety of evils and variety of things that we get from that. So we have to go back and understand that you didn't just happen, and you're not here by chance. You're here because of God. God is the creator, and God is the one who gives life. He made the world. He's the Lord of heaven and earth. He says he doesn't dwell in temples made with hands. It says he's not worshipped with men's hands, as though he needed anything, seeing he giveth to all life and breath and all things. See, he gives, who gives life? God does. Who's in charge of giving life or taking life? God is. When we take that upon ourselves, we're taking the place of God. And we're thinking that we are instead of God. And then it says, He hath made of one blood all nations of men for to dwell on the face of the earth, and hath determined the times before appointed and the bounds of their habitation, that they should seek the Lord, if haply they might feel after him and find him, though he be not far from every one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. As certain also of your own poets have said, for we are his offspring. For as much then as we are the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the Godhead is like unto gold or silver or stone, graven by art and man's device. But if we're in the image of God, we're not stone and silver and wood. So how can that be? God must not be made of stone and silver and wood. Okay? And the times of this ignorance, God winked at. But now commandeth all men everywhere to repent. Why? Because he hath appointed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he hath ordained. Who's that man that he hath ordained? Jesus Christ. God will judge the world one day by Jesus Christ. You better believe that. Whereof he hath given assurance unto all men, in that he hath raised him from the dead. And when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked, others said, we'll hear thee again of this matter. So Paul departed from among them. Howbeit certain men clave unto him and believed. Among them was Dionysius, the Areopagite, and a woman named Demarius, and others with them. So we had a couple that got saved, a couple that believed and repented and asked Christ to be their Savior. Not his biggest revival that he ever had, for sure, and not necessarily the biggest results, but you understand, you can get someone to make a profession of faith and someone to say, yeah, I'll pray and ask Jesus to save me, but if they never believed, really believed, they were lost. Does that mean they're saved? No. They have to understand who God is and who they are and that they're lost and on their way to hell. And if they're never lost, they never really get saved. And you had to understand, I'm not asking you to just put God next to all the other gods. And a lot of times in other foreign countries, when you go to their countries and people get them to go in and say, okay, listen, you just... The Roman road, like we usually use. You can go to some of these countries like India and Thailand and some of these countries where there's multiple gods, and you can go in and say, we're all sinners. We deserve to pay a price for sin. Jesus died on the cross for you and paid that price. You have to accept Jesus as your Savior. And you know what? They'll say, okay. And they'll go home and they'll put the New Testament or the Bible right up with all the other gods and say, well, we've got that one covered too. And they would have gladly included the unknown God and put Jesus Christ there and put him in with all the other gods. But Jesus says, not, listen, that isn't a name that is among every other name. That is a name that is above every other name. It has to be Jesus alone. Neither is there salvation in any other. And so they have to understand that. And we do wrong if we don't help them to understand that, because they're not truly saved if they're just one of the one. So he had some folks converted there. But now we have in our country the what's called the LGBT community. And that is the lesbian and bisexual and gay and transgender community. LGBT. And the truth of the matter is, some of you may have never heard of that before. Some of, I guarantee you this, 34 years ago when I started the ministry, I'd never heard of such a thing. And I don't think America had heard of such a thing at that point. You know, I had this discussion with my wife this week. You know, I had always thought that your sex and your gender were the same thing. They're interchangeable. And that's, by the way, that's how it used to be. But one of the words that they have changed meanings of through the years is the word gender. Okay? The sex refers to your biological differences that are assigned to you at birth. Now, who assigned you those at birth? God does. God does. It's by the Creator. Gender, they say, refers to the role of a male or a female in society or an individual's concept of themselves. Now that's changed, and they have changed the meaning of that over the last 20 years. That's really a phenomenon in our lifetime. I would say my mom is still alive. In fact, this October she'll hit 90. But I tell you what, in my father's lifetime and my in-laws, you never heard of such a thing. And certainly in their parents' lifetime, you never heard of such things. There was no such thing. How come we never heard about it? Let me read you an article by Dr. Paul McHugh. He's from John Hopkins University Hospital. He's the former psychiatrist-in-chief for John Hopkins Hospital. And he's currently the Distinguished Service Professor of Psychiatry. He writes in the Wall Street Journal, and by the way, he's written 6 books and 125 peer-reviewed articles. And he makes the statement that transgenderism is a mental disorder that merits treatment. I'm quoting, that sex change is a biological impossibility, and that the people who promote sexual reassignment surgery are collaborating and promoting a mental disorder. That's not an independent fundamental Baptist preacher saying that. That's a doctor, a very respected one at Johns Hopkins University Hospital. He went on in the Wall Street Journal, he explained that transgender surgery is not the solution for people who suffer a disorder of what he says, quote, assumption. The notion that their maleness or femaleness is different than what nature assigned to them biologically. And of course, it's not nature assigned to them, but God assigned to them. He also reported in a new study showing that the suicide rate among transgendered people who had reassignment surgery is 20 times higher than the suicide rate among non-transgender people. He further noted, studies from Vanderbilt University and London's Portman Clinic of Children who had expressed transgender feelings, but for whom over time 70 to 80% spontaneously lost those feelings. They got over it. While the Obama administration and Hollywood and major media promote transgenderism as normal, Dr. McHugh says, quote, these policymakers in the media are doing no favors either to the public or to the transgendered by treating their confusions as a right in need of defending rather than as a mental disorder that deserves understanding, treatment, and prevention. This intensely felt sense of being transgendered constitutes a mental disorder in two respects. The first idea is the idea of sex misalignment is simply mistaken. It doesn't correspond with physical reality. And the second is it leads to grim psychological outcomes. The transgendered person's disorder, says Dr. McHugh, is the person's assumption that they're different than the physical reality of their body. Their maleness or femaleness has assigned by nature, is assigned by God. It's a disorder similar to a dangerously thin person who suffers from anorexia, who looks in the mirror and thinks they're overweight. They are thin and they don't have anything, but when they look in the mirror, they see somebody who's fat. Reality, you and I look at that and say, reality says that ain't right. And what do? They get help for that. And they have gotten help for that. And they have gotten over that. That's the same thing. And it's funny. We can look at someone like that, and they say, yeah, you need to get some help for that. And they get that turned around, and they go on to live a healthy life. I think in one of the RU videos, there's a young girl who's like that and got into anorexia and the binging eating and then, you know, and now she talked about the victory in Christ and how, and I think she's eating pizza and the thing, you know, and doesn't worry about what's on her plate and counting things. God's given her the victory in that. And we can just say, you can look at somebody and say, well, you know, you can say what you want, but you're not fat. And but we can look at someone else and say, I don't care what you say, you're not a woman or you're not a man. And all of a sudden we're bigoted and we're prejudiced. And we're not right in saying that. So it's not being consistent. The assumption that one's gender is only in their mind, regardless of their anatomical reality, has led some transgendered people to push for social acceptance and affirmation of their subjective personal truth. As a result, some states have passed laws barring psychiatrists. You ready for this? They bar psychiatrists, even with parental permission, from striving to restore natural gender feelings to a transgender minor. They're forbidden to do it. The pro-transgender advocates do not want to know, said McHugh, that studies show between 70 and 80% of children who express those transgender feelings spontaneously lose those feelings over time. For those who had sexual reassignment surgery, most said they were satisfied with the operation, but their subsequent psychosocial adjustments were no better than those who did not have any surgery. And by the way, the Obama administration announced this past May, almost a year ago, that Medicare now covers the transgender surgical procedure. By the way, at Johns Hopkins, Dr. McHugh again, we stopped doing sex reassignment surgery because producing a satisfied but still troubled patient seemed an inadequate reason for surgically amputating normal organs. The chief of psychiatry also warned against enabling or encouraging certain subgroups of the transgendered, such as young people susceptible to suggestion from everything is normal, and the school's diversity counselors, who like cult leaders, may encourage these young people to distance themselves from their families and offer advice on rebutting arguments against having the transgender surgery. There's even doctors who work with young children who seem to imitate the opposite gender, and they'll administer puberty-delaying hormones to render late sex change surgeries, even though the drugs stunt the children's growth and risk causing them to be sterile. He said such actions comes close to child abuse, especially when you consider that 80% of those children will abandon their confusion and naturally grow into adult life if they're just left untreated. He said, sex change is biologically impossible. People who undergo sex reassignment surgery do not change from men to women or vice versa. Rather, they become feminized men or masculinized women. Claiming that that's a civil rights matter and encouraging surgical intervention is in reality to collaborate and promote a mental disorder. So listen, biblically, it's not normal. In the beginning, God made them male and female. Okay? That settles it. In the beginning, and medically, it's not possible, but we're dealing with it in our society. It's the world in which we live. All North Carolina did was pass a law that says you use whatever restroom it says you are on your birth certificate. That's all the law said. And they say that's discrimination. And that's what everybody's upset about. They said whatever it says on your birth certificate, you were born a male or a female, that's the restroom you use. So what do we do? What do we do as believers? I've seen all kinds of responses. Let me read a couple of them that go across the board. For the very reason that homosexual practice is wrong, transsexualism is all the more wrong because it's even greater complaint against God for the way that one's made. When he, this is referring to Bruce Jenner, the most closely resembles is a mentally disordered man who is being manipulated by disingenuous liberals and self-obsessed gay activists. Other Christians say this, well, I see a value in a disability lens that sees gender dysphoria as a reflection of a fallen world in which the condition itself is not a moral choice. Another one says, another Christian, only God knows why Caitlin is transgender, and therefore only God can judge, A, if she's sinning or not, and B, if she has any level of culpability in it. And then others who call themselves Christians give their full affirmation and support. It's insane that anyone has to say this, but again, there's no sin in being gay or lesbian or bisexual or transgender or questioning. Another one said, shouldn't the idea of people being at peace in their own body resonate with everyone, especially Christians? And so you have the whole, from you know, basically let's kill them to let's accept them. Everything in between from Christians. But what is our position? Now let me also say this, that our our position's important, but so is our disposition. All right? It's important that we not only believe right, but we also believe it in the right way. And let me give you a few simple thoughts, okay? Number one, let's not tell a sinful world to stop sinning. We're not going to tell the world to stop sinning. Sinners, why do you know, we're not sinners because we sin. We sin because we are sinners. That's what we are. And that's what the world without Christ is. Now, I want you to go in your Bibles from Acts to Romans. Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1. Romans gives us the slippery slope that we begin to go down when we know God, but we don't glorify Him as God. And we see where that leads. Verse number 21 says, because that when they knew God, they glorified Him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like to corruptible man, and to birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things. Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie, and watch, worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. God, they begin to worship and serve the creature more than the Creator. And Paul goes beyond that and begins to draw a parallel with the human sexuality when he talks about the physical nature revealing the truth about God and the truth about sexual identity. He says, for this cause God gave them up to vile affection. For even the women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. And likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burn in their lust one toward another, men with men, working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error which was meet. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. You see, if a man looks at his own body and chooses to play the part of a woman or a woman vice versa, they're without excuse. They're without excuse. God designed us in the way He designed us. You were born as a man or a woman, as a male or a female. Now it says God gives them over to a reprobate mind. The reprobate, it's interesting. It's disallow. That's what repro means. And then probo is to prove. Disallow, proof. So when God gives up the reprobate mind, you know what you do? You won't listen to anybody to try to prove you're wrong. You will not listen to proof. And that's where we are. What do you do with someone who believes in the evolution when they won't listen to proof? There's nothing you can say that'll prove to them it's wrong. It's really to be abandoned in sin, lost to virtue and grace. It's what Titus says when they profess they know God, but in works they deny Him, being abominable and disobedient, and to every good work reprobate. But remember, the Bible says in the last days that evil men and seducers will wax worse and worse. If the Lord tarries His coming, it's not getting better. It'll get worse. So what are we supposed to do? Get up and yell at all of them and get angry? Tell them to stop it? You're telling sinners to stop sinning? See? They're incapable of doing that. So what are we supposed to do? We're supposed to do what Paul did. Number two, proclaim the gospel. Proclaim the gospel. Don't build walls, build some bridges. I'm not going to debate them. I am going to share the truth about Jesus Christ with them. that Christ is available to all that seek Him. You learn from Christ how to build bridges to people and talk to people rather than build walls. Jesus taught that when He came to the woman at the well in John chapter 4. The Samaritan woman. The Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. When the disciples left and they came back, Jesus is talking to her. Now remember, it's the middle of the day. You're going to water your herds and water your animals, come out for the water. You come out early in the morning before the heat of the day. Why is she there at the high noon? Why is she there at the peak of the heat of the day? Why would she come to the well then? Because no one else would be there. Now she has had five different husbands, or people she's lived with. In fact, she's living with a man now she's not married to. Now while we have kind of come to accept that in our society, it was not acceptable in that society. Talk about an outcast. Well, could everyone who knew who she was, what kind of woman she was. And I'll guarantee you there are even some Samaritans that didn't want to even talk to her. And she goes out there, and imagine her surprise when Jesus is there. That's okay. She was just going to get her water and go on her way and not say anything. But He spoke to her. Give me some water. Surprised her. What are you speaking to me for? Let me ask you a question. When you see a Muslim or a Somalian, do you build a wall? Or do you think about how you might have a conversation and say something to them about Jesus Christ? What do you do? Would you be like one of the disciples if you saw somebody talking to them? You come back and say, what are you talking to them for? That's what the disciples said. What are you talking to her for? Man, we don't talk to those people. That's what they said. But by the way, woman at the well got saved, didn't she? She needed to hear about Jesus Christ. There are numbers. I had somebody post that. Who posted that about the number of Muslims being saved? Record number of Muslims. Is that your wife who put that on Facebook, I think it was, Brother Ron? It's amazing what God is doing in their lives. And God, listen, you don't have to go over to their countries and put your life in line. God has brought them here. And you can you see them every day like I do. What are we doing to reach them for Christ? When they brought to Jesus a woman that they said was taken in adultery in the very act, they all had stones ready to stone her, and they just wanted Jesus to say the word so they could all start throwing the stones. And Jesus said, well, whichever one of you is without sin, he can throw the first stone. He stooped down and wrote on the ground. We don't know what he wrote in the ground. The Bible doesn't tell us, and so it must not be something God wanted us to know. Some people think he maybe started writing down some of their sins. And when they saw that he knew about them, they just kind of dropped their stones and walked away. I don't know. I know this. He could have done that because he did know their sins. It's possible. But finally, they were all gone. Jesus turned to her and said, woman, where are thine accusers? And she said, hath no man condemned thee? You know what she said? She said, well, no man, Lord. No man, Lord. And that's when Jesus said, neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. That's good news, isn't it? You know, a world that's full of bad news and a world full with hateful people and angry people. They need a message of love and a message of forgiveness and a message of hope. There's hope in Jesus Christ. And that's the only hope there is. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. We need to give them the message. What would be your response to the world? Do you react in the flesh? Or do you respond in the spirit? You have to be careful with these things, that when these things come up, that we don't react in the flesh and get caught up in being more of an American than we are a Christian. I'm an American and I love America, but that pales in comparison to my love for Jesus Christ and my allegiance to God. That has to be first. Number three. The third statement to remember is this: we are in the world, but we're not of the world. It means that we live in the world, but we don't have to be conformed to the ways of this world. We can take a stand. Our shield from the world is the Word of God. Our shield from the world is the local church. We come out, a church is a called out assembly of believers. Called out from where? The world. Place to get away from the world and the things of the world is to come to church and be in the house of God. And that's why the Bible says it's not so much the less as you see the day approaching, it's so much the more as you see the day approaching. You want to be in church more, you want to be around the people of God more. Staying in the Word of God and staying around the people of God will help you focus on Him and see things from an eternal perspective, not a temporary one. We're still the salt of the earth and the light of the world. Salt, it didn't stop corruption. It helped prevent the spread of corruption. That's our job. Target came out with their policy that they would let anybody who identifies with that male or female to use their restrooms. They have pulled back on that. The American Family Association, I think in just a matter of a couple days since Target announced that, had over 300,000 signatures that they sent to Target, and they are now reviewing their policy. They will probably come up with a separate restroom that those people can use if they want to, but they're to stay out of the other ones. And that's good. Take a stand. That's all right. But boy, be careful that you take your stand in the right way. I'm not. They may not like me because of my position, but they ought not to not like me because of my disposition. We have to stand. Ephesians 6 and the warfare that it talks about, wrestling. We fight not against flesh and blood. The enemy's not Target. The enemy isn't even the transgender person or the lesbian or the homosexual. We're not wrestling against flesh and blood. So stop thinking they're the enemy. No, they're a soul for whom Christ died. They're in bondage to false thoughts and bondage to strongholds that only Christ can free them from. Is there still power in the gospel or not? Is Christ still able to change people's lives or not? And if we believe that, why are we not telling them about Jesus Christ and letting them know what can help them? Stand, therefore. You read over and over in Ephesians 6 about the armor to stand. You have to take your stand. And by the way, we maybe slipped as far as we have in America because we haven't taken our stand like we should. Nothing wrong with taking a stand and taking it in the right way. But you know, listen, let me remind you, the answer, part of our problem is we've gotten away from giving the gospel to people. Yes, sir. Don't raise your hand, but how many of you in the last week tried to give the gospel to somebody? No, don't raise your hand. I just said don't raise your hand. Boy, you guys don't listen. Huh? Don't raise your hand. How many did? Huh? It's a shame on believers when they say that more people are converting to the Muslim religion than they are converting to Christianity. Shame on us. Don't get all upset. How are those Muslims? No. Get a mirror out and say, how are those Christians? That Christian right there, the one I'm looking at. We have to do the job. We have to do what God's called us to do. Once upon a time, two brothers lived on adjoining farms. They fell into a conflict with each other. It was first serious rift they had in 40 years of farming side by side. They shared machinery. They traded labor and goods as needed, always without a hitch. But their longtime friendship fell apart. Began with just a small understanding, but grew into a major difference and finally exploded into a bitter exchange of words followed by weeks of silence. One morning there was a knock on John's door. He opened it to find a man with a carpenter's toolbox. He said, I'm looking for a few days' work. Perhaps you have a few small jobs around here that I could help you with? And John said, yes, I do. I have a job for you. Look across the creek at that farm. That's my neighbor. In fact, it's my younger brother. Last week there was a meadow between us. But he took his bulldozer to the river levee, and now there's a creek between us. Well, he may have done that to spite me, but I'll get him one better. You see that pile of lumber by the barn? I want you to build me a fence, a 10-foot fence, so I won't need to see his place or his face anymore. The carpenter said, I think I understand the situation. Show me the nails and the post hole digger and I'll be able to do a job that pleases you. The older brother had to go to town, and so he helped the carpenter get the materials ready and he took off for the day. The carpenter worked hard all that day, measuring, sawing, nailing, digging. About sunset, the farmer returned and the carpenter had just finished his job. The farmer's eyes opened wide. His jaw dropped. Because there was no fence there at all. It was a bridge. A bridge that stretched from one side of the creek to the other. A fine piece of work, handrails and all on the bridge. And his neighbor, his younger brother, was coming up the other side of the bridge with his hand outstretched. He said, you're quite a fellow to build a bridge after all that I said and done. The two brothers stood at the middle of the bridge, taking each other's hand. And they turned to see the carpenter hoist his toolbox on his shoulder. No, wait, stay a few days. I've got other projects for you. The carpenter said, well, I'd love to stay on, but I have many more bridges to build. I want you to remember some things. God's not going to ask what kind of car you drove, but he might ask you how many people you drove who didn't have transportation. He won't ask about the square footage of your house, but he will ask you how many people you welcomed into your home. He won't ask you about the clothes you had in your closet, but he'll ask you how many you helped to clothe. He won't ask how many material possessions you had, but he'll ask if they dictated your life. He won't ask what your highest salary was, but he'll ask you if you compromised your character to obtain it. He won't ask you how much overtime you worked, but he'll ask you if your overtime work was for yourself or for your family. He won't ask you how many promotions you received, but he'll ask you how you promoted others. He won't ask what your job title was, but he'll ask you if you performed your job to the best of your ability. God won't ask you what you did to help yourself, but he'll ask you what you did to help others. God's not going to ask you how many friends you had, but he'll ask you how many people to whom you were a friend. He won't ask you what neighborhood you lived in, but he'll ask you how you treated your neighbors. He's not going to ask you about the color of your skin, but he will ask about the content of your character. Are you building bridges? Are you building walls? This is not the time in America for Christians to build a wall and say, I don't want anything to do with anybody. when it gets darkest, the light ought to shine the brightest. And it's a great opportunity for us to shine the light. Let's take the light to people. Let's let them know the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Yes, the world's dark, and yes, the world's seemingly out of control. But the answer is still Jesus Christ. That's the answer. May God help us to preach the gospel, because it's Christ that transforms lives. You ought to have tracts. You ought to have every opportunity to give the gospel to somebody. Just say, hey, read this. It'll tell you you can know you have eternal life. It'll tell you you can be certain you're on your way to heaven. And when I've given that to people, I've having people refuse that. And you say it with compassion, and you say it with love in your heart. But let's get the gospel out. So many that don't know. Let's have a loving message to a hateful world. Amen? Let's pray, shall we? Father, take the truth now this evening. Lord, thank you for Paul going in the middle of Athens, preaching the gospel. His response to those folks and his plainness to them and yet his love for them to tell them about Jesus Christ. And Lord, even in that idolatrous city, there were some who believed. And Lord, forgive us for looking sometimes at our country and complaining about the different groups and complaining about sinners who sin, instead of looking at them and saying, these are people who we need to reach with the gospel of Jesus Christ. You told the disciples to lift up their eyes and look on the fields, for they are white, ready to harvest. Our fields are white, Lord. Give us eyes to see that. Give our church a vision to reach those folks with Jesus, with the gospel of Christ, please. Allow us to be a lighthouse. Build those bridges, not walls, to give the gospel to people everywhere we go. May your commission to take the gospel to every person be our consuming passion. May you use us to reach many for Jesus Christ. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. I wonder how many folks tonight would just say, preacher, the Spirit of God spoke to my heart tonight about reaching our world. Hey, I don't know about the world 50 years ago. That's when the people from 50 years ago had to do their job. This is our world. This is our time. This is our generation. To reach it with the gospel. What are we doing? What are you doing? What am I doing? Wonder if God spoke to your heart tonight. And you say, Pastor, the Spirit of God spoke to my heart this evening. Please pray for me tonight. Slip your hand up, Christian, will you? Amen. 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 You may put them down. In a moment I'll pray and we'll have our invitation. I believe it all starts on our knees before God, asking God to use us and asking God to give us the boldness we need to speak up for Jesus Christ. Can they love their idols, or can they love their God more than we love ours? That ought not to be. Let's ask God to help us to love him and to serve him as we should in these days. Father, thank you for speaking to our hearts tonight. I pray, God, that you'll hear our prayers. We bend our knee to you now this evening. May something start here in this room, Lord. And I don't know when you'll come back, Lord. Maybe you'll come back this evening and none of this will matter. But if you tarry, you're coming, and this is the world we'll live in these last days. We want to be faithfully serving you and reaching others for Christ until you return. We want to be effective in our witness and effective in reaching others for Christ. And so, Lord, we bow the knee to you and we beg for your power and your blessing. That you'll use us and the Spirit of God will empower us and fill us to give the gospel to others. Lord, we'll begin to impact our community, our little corner of the world right here in Grove City in Columbus, Ohio, with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Have your way now in every heart and have your way in this invitation, and I'll thank you for it. Quietly with your heads bowed, you stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, the pianist will play. As she plays, Brother Bob's going to sing. God has spoken to your heart. Respond to him this evening, will you please?
I wonder, have I done my best for Jesus, who died upon that cruel tree? To think of his great sacrifice at Calvary, I know my Lord expects the best from me. How many are the lost that I have lifted? How many are the chained I've helped to free? I wonder, have I done my best for Jesus when he has done so much for me? The hours that I have wasted are so many. The hours I've spent for Christ so few. Because of all my lack of love for Jesus, I wonder if his heart is breaking too. How many are the lost that I have lifted? How many are the chained I've helped to free? I wonder, have I done my best for Jesus when he has done so much for me? I wonder, have I cared enough for others, or have I let them die alone? I might have helped a wanderer to the Savior, the seed of precious life I might have sown. How many are the lost that I have lifted? How many are the chained I've helped to free? I wonder, have I done my best for Jesus when he has done so much for me? No longer will I stay within the valley. I'll climb to mountain heights above. The world is dying now for want of someone to tell them of the Savior's matchless love.
Sing that with him.
How many are the lost that I have lifted? How many are the chained I've helped to free? I wonder, have I done my best for Jesus when he has done so much for me?
Father, I pray you'll help us to live our lives in light of the fact we're going to see you one day. And we'll look at the nail piercings in your hands and your feet, the wound in your side. We'll be reminded of what you went through for us. Lord, just as you've worked miracles in our life, you have changed us in dramatic fashion. Oh, help us to realize the power that's in the gospel. Give us, with great boldness, we could speak the word of God to people. And give us a love in our heart that you have for people, that we would love them because we love you. We reach them with the gospel of Christ. Now, Lord, take us from this place and make us mindful that you're going with us as we leave tonight. Make us mindful of your presence as we go. And, Lord, I pray that as we meet people this week, we'll introduce them to you. Use us to do your work this week, Lord, in the way you'd want it to be done. Glorify yourself in us, please. Use us to bear fruit for your honor and glory. Thank you for a wonderful day in the house of God. Dismiss us now with your blessing, please. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. It's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. Let's sing it together. See you tomorrow night. Chick-fil-A, 5 o'clock, all right? Hey, it's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. It's a grand thing to follow Jesus. Anywhere and everywhere I go, for it's a grand thing to be a soldier in his army here below. It's the grandest thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. God bless you. You are dismissed.